Everyone tell us who you are and what you do. But 20 seconds, please.
This is Ankit from iCreate, technology enthusiast.
I don't think in case you don't know iCreate, and this is more for the international guys, iCreate is a incubator, come education, come everything around entrepreneurship.
iCreate is an autonomous center, Government of Gujarat initiative, a technology business incubator.
Sir.
Hi, I'm Ravin. I am with Venture Studio as the head coach. Venture Studio is an incubation center set up by Ahmedabad University, a private university in Ahmedabad, in collaboration with the Stanford University's D School. And we run several programs for incubation and acceleration. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Karthik from I2D Incubating IoT Dreams. We are an incubator solely focused on incubating IoT products.
Prasanna gets to choose who to give prizes to.
I'm GAK Kumar from Agribusiness Incubation Center of National Rice Research Institute.
Hi, I'm Priyank from Ashoka University. I head the Center for Entrepreneurship at Ashoka. Ashoka is based in Delhi, in Sonipat. And I also run an incubator accelerator program on smart cities. So we actually do a lot of work in IoT as well. Thanks.
So I'm Professor Samir Khandekar, Department of Mechanical Engineering, IIT Kanpur. And I am presently heading the SIDBI Innovation and Incubation Center within the campus. We are incubating about 30 companies right now. We were established about 15 years back.
Okay. Super. We'll do this and international guys, and for the backbenchers, we'll come back to you later.
Hi, I'm Elizabeth from IIT Madras Incubation Cell. The incubation cell oversees incubation activities of our three sector-specific incubators, RTBI, which is Rural Technologies, MedTech, Bio-incubator, yes.
Roland, you can just say Roland. I'm Roland from 91 Springboards.
Yeah, myself Agil from Kerala Startup Mission. We are like the implementing AC in Kerala for all the startup activities. Our CEO was supposed to come yesterday, but he was ill, so he couldn't make it in the panel. So I came in for him.
Yeah, no one needed to know that. You were the important
guy. Hi, good evening. I'm Silva, representing the Finnish Innovation Funding Agency, TEKES, based in New Delhi, looking for collaborations between Indian and Finnish startups.
She gives a lot of money. No. Yeah, I was just making you feel.
Hi, everyone. My name is Alpha, representing Malaysia, Kulim High Tech Park.
Hi, everyone. I'm Rani from Kulim High Tech Park as well, from Malaysia. So we are here to learn more about incubation, to bring the technology to Malaysia. Thank you.
My name is Sule Kåre Petersen. I'm from Innovation Center Denmark, that is based at the Embassy of Denmark in New Delhi. And I'm here to learn about the best practices of incubators in India.
Look international, but they are as Indian as a lot of us.
Hello everyone, I'm Rajneesh from Biotechnology Industry Research Assistance Council. We are a funding organization. We fund a lot of entrepreneurship, development programs, startup companies, and incubator in India itself.
Okay. Rest of you, when you ask questions, you're supposed to tell us who you are, but I'll take the mic back. Okay, with that, thank you. Oh. They just told me what I need to do. So joking. How we decided we'll do this panel is where we thought I'll take some time of these guys to just bring out what they've been doing and what they think of the topic. But more importantly, the idea was to get the panel open super quickly to question answers so that we can really answer questions you have in mind and when you're sitting there as audience, what got you here? Sounds good? So start thinking of the questions, right? I'll just pass the mic starting from Yujit. Give us your background and also your organizations.
All right, thanks, Wen. Thank you all for being here today. Really appreciate it. Just to give you a quick background, my name is Jeet Vijay. I run the Bahu Incubator at College of Engineering, Pune. We recently got 14 crore in funding from DST last week, so that's a good news. Prior to coming at Bhav Institute, I was in US for the last 17 years. By trade, I'm an investor. I run an investment fund, $50 million fund, focused on investing in startup technologies that are coming out of university setup. So sector agnostic, looking at nanofiber, 3D printing, digital media, artificial intelligence. And now we're looking at startups in India and seeing how we develop this ecosystem.
Hi, I'm Prasanna. I work with startups at the Microsoft Accelerator. I've done two startups in the past for about 7 years. Done a couple of angel investments, working with startups in the Microsoft Accelerator. Have coached about 120 entrepreneurs at the Microsoft Accelerator. I'm also a fellow at iSpirit. I run a program for pre-entrepreneurs, for people who want to become entrepreneurs or have just become entrepreneurs. So that's also could be of interest to the incubations.
Hi everyone, I'm Santosh. I work with two organizations. I'm the co-founder at F6S. F6S is world's largest platform for founders. We have over 1.5 million founders on our platform. 99% of incubators use us, incubators and accelerators, including the ones on the panel. And I also lead operations for Cairo Society in India. Cairo Society is the only fund focusing on under 25 entrepreneurs. And we are one of the three official agencies of Startup India. Thanks.
Hi, good evening. My name is Rajiv Vaishnav. I head the ecosystem and partnerships at GenNext Innovation Hub. GenNext is a part of Reliance Enterprise, RIL Group. I've joined them recently around 8 months back. Prior to that, I was with NASSCOM for almost 13 years. And I was the first employee of TIE in India. So I'm associated with the startup ecosystem almost for the last 16 years. Thank you.
Actually, I didn't realize startup ecosystem in India was that old. For me, I'm Pranay. I'm the co-founder of 91 Springboard. We are the biggest co-working network across India with centers in Delhi, Bombay, Bangalore, Hyderabad, and about 600 odd enterprises, actually more than that, working out of our hubs. Wonderful. So I'm Soma.
Hello everyone, I'm Soma Chattopadhyay, manager incubator of Venture Center, which is a CSIR NCL based incubator in Pune. Thank you.
Super. So I'm blessed with an amazing panel because there are people with VC background, people working at student entrepreneurship level, people working at supporting well-funded startup level also, and all variety. At this time, just to ensure we are all on the same plane when we talk terminologies, can I ask you to put that first slide on? So Prasanna, as any analytics guy, you had made graphs. Can you explain this to us?
Okay. So I'm not, I hope it's readable at the back. So this is the maturation of a startup, right? And any startup goes through these stages: inception, prototype, rollout, growth, expansion, and maturity. And as they go, you'll look at the bottom, things become more green and more yellow and less red, right? So red is high risk, green is very low risk, yellow is medium risk. So as a startup goes through this journey, they start earning more money. And that's why the red curve is going up, because you know money is what you want to make. Now, just for our sake, from a terminology perspective, we're defining an incubator as someone who takes a startup from zero to prototype, or you know, maybe the first or second sale. An accelerator we are defining as someone who takes from a prototype stage all the way up to a decent amount of revenue. And a scalerator takes someone with a decent amount of revenue and helps them grow past the hump of early growth, right? So they may up to say $1 million in revenue or $5 million in revenue. And the reason this is important is because at each of these transitions, there is very high mortality in startups. They die because they don't know how to make that transition from, I have an idea, I need to build a prototype, or I have a prototype, I need to make the first sale, or I made 10 sales, I need to figure out how to make 1,000 sales, right? At each of these stages, there's very high mortality. And so we're defining these three entities as people who can help somebody cross that bridge, right? And that's the kind of context for us in this conversation. So when we say incubator, this is what we mean, accelerator and scale rate.
Okay. So with that, let me ask a few rapid-fire questions. Let's start the other way around, Rajiv. Are you incubator, accelerator?
In between accelerator and scalerator.
Okay. Number of startups you supported?
33.
Do you take equity?
No.
Do you invest?
Yes.
So you invest and you don't take equity?
No. When you said when we incubate them in the accelerator, we don't take equity, but we invest in them.
Okay. How much do you invest?
Sweet spot, 3 to 5 million.
Okay. Have you have exits till now?
Not yet.
What stage startups do you focus on?
A mature stage where they have revenue, they are at a growth, they are looking for growth, but sometimes we also go for post-prototype and, at the customer traction. We would prefer an angel-invested startup to come to us.
So Prasanna is irritated, he thinks you should call yourself scalerator, but you call yourself accelerator.
Yeah, accelerator and scalerator, somewhere in between. We have mixed batch, yeah.
Okay. And sectors you focus on?
Predominantly, the startups that align the best with Reliance BUs are the primary sectors because there we can add more value, but otherwise any disruptive technologies.
Okay. Santosh, we'll skip you in this. You aren't, unfortunately, an incubator. We'll come back to you. Don't worry. Incubator, accelerator,
scalerator.
Years of existence?
4.
Number of startups supported?
In India, 96. Worldwide, 550.
Okay. You take equity?
No.
Do you invest?
No.
And
we have a separate investment entity which invests in a set of startups, maybe from our funnel.
Not related. Okay. And in your case, the scalerator bit of it is this limited period?
So the way it works is the program is 4 months.
Okay.
But they continue to be in our portfolio. They continue to work with us.
Okay. And sectors?
We look for tech product startups. For product startups that are outside of our core areas, we work with partners like Reliance, Ashoka, ISDI, who have their own sectors of experience.
Okay. I'll come back to that bit. But meanwhile, passing it on to Jeet. Jeet, incubator, accelerator.
So we are an academic institution-based incubator.
Incubator.
Right.
Sectors you're looking to focus on?
So our thing is it has to be convergence of industries and disruption of industries. Buzzwords, but to put it in layman's term, we look at IoT, healthcare technologies, and since we want to make Pune the smart hub for cybersecurity, we are looking at a lot of cybersecurity startups.
Are you looking to invest?
We don't take equity in these startups. It's for free, more or less, but we have a venture arm that takes equity when makes investment.
How much money are you investing?
So it depends, anywhere from early seed, where we put in like, let's say 10 lakh to get the business plan going and move on forward, but our sweet spot will be less than 50 lakh.
Okay, and have you supported any startups already? You're new, right?
Yeah, no, but still thing has been in operational for last few years. So we got 30 companies in our portfolio that we're mentoring, not invested in, but in our mentorship program.
Okay, and super. So that sort of gives us some basics on It gives you a sense on who's doing what and sort of linked to your issues, like who's probably going to be the right person. I've kept Santosh quiet for a long time, but he's your sneaky guy who's looking at all data in the back, like every incubator, what companies are going there, etc., etc. So Santosh, let me start with you. Just on like this question on incubation best practices, based on what you've been seeing variety of incubators are doing, what are, according to you, the three most important thing you'll talk about?
Okay. So, I mean, if I am an incubator, since we analyze at the back end, like almost all the incubators in the world, if I am an incubator, what are the three things I will focus on? First thing, founders. Finding high quality founders is a big challenge for incubators because you are going to work with a lot of founders and your success is directly proportional to the success of your founders. So unless you find great quality founders, again, subjective, trying to get at an evaluation criteria, you won't be successful because, you all know the success rates of startups. So one, finding great founders, and two, founders' time, right? So optimizing founders' time is one of the most important thing because if your founders are productive, there's high chances of them being a little more I mean, the probability increases in terms of success. How can you do that? You can do that by moving all your operations onto digital. That's moving onto our platform. And then third thing is data. Let's just say in a hypothetical scenario, only 1% of your founders will make it. So it's important for you to figure out who are those 1%, like, or who might be those 1%, so that you also focus a little more on them. That way, you are actually inching a little more closer to your success. So data is very important. Again, data is also running on our platform, right? So right from a deal sourcing, as in finding startups, to tracking these startups for lifelong, runs on F6S, right? So once you associate with the founder who is associated with your program, wherever they go across the world, be it to Techstars, be it to Startup Bootcamp, or any organization in the world, you get notified. So data is one of the most important thing because you need to know your founder's mindset, right? Yeah. So those are the three things for
me. So you are telling us focus on the top 2-3 startups and don't look at the rest.
No, not really. Finding those 2% is extremely important, right? And it's also a guesswork, but guesswork works better with data than guesswork, right?
So Jeet, the reason I passed you the mic is you're the only not-for-profit incubator in the setup. I'm right, right? You're the not-for-profit, DST kinds.
Yeah, we are non-profit, right.
So are you allowed to say this, right? Like, of 10, I want to support just 2 and the others can flounder.
See, I wouldn't agree with that wholeheartedly, but what I'll say is that we need to identify who our true customer here is. Yes, support these startups, get the right founders, but ultimately it has to be our fundable startups. Though we run as a nonprofit incubator, the idea is not every idea is a startup. So curation is an important element of creation. So we need to identify, engage, and support the right kind of startups, and where the ideas don't lend themselves to being into a profitable startups, we should channel the entrepreneurs to move their energy into more productive ways.
Okay. And so I'll ask the mic to be passed to Prasanna. I don't know if you've known Prasanna enough as I have, but he's your research guy. Like, he comes with structured thoughts. So Prasanna, tell us these best practices and tell us things that you think probably not more than 10% in this room are doing, preferably.
Can you switch to the slide, the next page, please? So, again, I'm hoping that this is visible on your screen, right? So I'll just briefly tell you what we do at the Accelerator, very structured program. Worldwide, we have more than 9,000 applications, and we've taken about 100 of them last year. So it's a very, very selective program. But once the program starts, how do we serve different types of entrepreneurs differently, right? So we have 4 levels of interventions that we do. Strategic interventions are designed to change the way that entrepreneurs think, right? And so these are packed into the beginning of the program. So literally, we're changing the way they behave, changing the way they think in very short, pointed workshops. Second is the mentor meetings, right? And the way we use mentors is different from general. So what we found is that if you want general purpose mentoring, it takes a lot of time from the mentor. Easily 8 to 12 hours the mentor will need to spend just to get up to speed on what the startup is doing, right? And most mentors are not ready to spend that. So instead, what we do is we are the general mentors. We get specific mentors, subject matter experts, such that, let's say somebody has built their prototype, they want to go to market, they're building a app, mobile app, right? So their specific question is, how do I do the first 1,000 sales of my app, right? So we will connect them to somebody who is an entrepreneur who has done that 6 months ago. And so when they go to that person, they're not asking a general question, they're asking a very specific question, and that question can be answered in half an hour. And what that person might have taken 3 months, 4 months to find out, instead they're getting an answer in half an hour, right? And probably even a playbook saying, hey, just go and do this, you'll get your first 1,000 sales. The third one is learning. We just have classes. These are your half an hour, 1 hour sessions from past entrepreneurs, from others, experts. This is more useful for early stage entrepreneurs, less useful for late stage entrepreneurs. The third is transactional interventions, where we take them to customers,
We take them to market. We also provide investor access. And if you see, we do that in the second half of the program. So once they've changed the way they're thinking and they've started doing things differently, then meeting these folks is useful. The last is something that is super critical that we do. We do a weekly business review, which is a half an hour in-depth review of everything that the startup has done, has promised that they will do in that week, and what they've asked us, what we are supposed to do in that week. And we do that week on week for the 16 weeks that they're in the program. And typically, each startup then makes it a part of their own cadence, and they have internal weekly business reviews. So these are kind of the elements that we put together. And if you know what net promoter score is, in the last couple of batches, our net promoter score is above 80, 85.
Okay.
That's because of the structure of what we do.
And just so that we are able to understand the context even better, how big is your team, the full-time team working on this?
So there are four people who are full-time working with the startups.
Okay.
One person is taking care of the CEO kind of a role for the startups.
Okay.
One person is me taking care of the product and the growth roles.
Okay.
One person is helping them connect to customers.
Okay.
And one person is connecting them to investors.
And typically, how many startups are there in a batch?
So we have a lot of engagement with the alumni. So
okay.
What basically happens is about 60% of our time is spent with the current batch, which is 12 to 14 startups. And about 40% of the time is spent with our 100 alumni from the past cohorts.
Oh, okay. Super. Super. Rajiv.
Yes.
You are a very interesting incubator, accelerator, come scalator, which is based out of a industrial house.
Yes.
And interestingly, you have tie up with Microsoft too.
Mm-hmm.
So what can we learn from you? And everyone has stopped marketing. Everyone has tie up with F6S. F6S is great. Now we'll come to you with specific questions.
Awesome. Yeah, so first of all, I think the structured program that Prasanna has just spoken is the structured program that we also use because our program is powered by Microsoft. And Prasanna is the person who takes care of the startups and their training. So an awesome experience to be a part of his sessions.
So just so that I understand it better, when you say powered by, he shows you this graph, this chart, and he says, now do it, or like, what does it have?
Yeah, so we are evolving. In a sense, we are into our third batch, and the third batch is graduating in a couple of days. So we are also learning, and they are expanding their network with other corporates and other startups and incubators. So it is important for us to create some in-house capabilities. And I think that transition is taking place where they are helping us and our teams to understand the way they deliver the content and the way they have structured the program to learn and slowly start taking over things. But there will be few, the heart of the program, say in technology, the product development and all that. We will keep on looking at Prasanna for his help on a continuous basis. So all these other aspects that we spoke about, like the mentor connects and other things, that definitely our teams are taking care of.
Okay.
But when it comes to the hardcore technology interventions, we look
Microsoft
up to
Microsoft team
yeah,
comes in.
Yeah, yeah.
And what else? Like as an incubator, when we are thinking of best practices to engage with corporate...
Our case also, when we are filtering the startups and out of the number of applicants that we select around 12 to 15 startups, our focus also is that how the startups, their technologies, their ideas are aligned with Reliance BUs. And when I'm talking about Reliance BUs, that could be retail, there could be, again, oil and gas, there could be, Jio as an application, the network applications, mobile apps and mobile space. Then we are also looking at IoT and general disruptions that you are seeing in the market. We are looking at these kind of verticals. There can be horizontals also, like logistic could be a horizontal, cybersecurity could be a horizontal, and we would be interested in these startups. So when we filter these startups, we try and see, and as I told you, right, that we are looking at relatively mature startups so that we can showcase them to the business units when a startup is
kind of meeting a business unit head, then they realize the kind of might that the largest enterprise of the country is demanding from the startup. And that is where thinking big is one thing that Reliance can provide to a startup at an early stage of their life cycle.
Okay. I'll ask one last question to Jeet, and then I'll open it up to audience. So Jeet, you were doing a lot of this in US, and now you're doing this in India. A few differences and their implications on best practices you're adopting here.
You know, one thing, US is a more mature market, and this industry is more developed in the US than here. But there are three level of differences, I think, that we need to be careful about and that we need to really think through. One is purpose, second is people, and third is performance. So purpose, whether be it in a nonprofit, academic incubator, where the purpose might be job creation, employment, or you know, entrepreneurship creation, or in private sector, where it might be, you know, whatever the business model be to maximize economic returns, right? We gotta be really careful about what the purpose is. So just like any corporate, gotta have a clear vision, mission, and goals. Second thing is process. And that's where, you know, F6 and Microsoft and these guys who have really sharpened it, like especially Microsoft, these guys know what they are doing, how they're doing, and how to codify it. So implementing right processes to measure, report on performance is critical. Third is people. And I think that gets overly underlooked, especially in academic incubators or nonprofit incubators, is you cannot hire, you know, if you pay peanuts, you get monkeys, right? So you got to hire the right team. You got to get the people who understand it, are committed to it, but they need to be rewarded for it. So aligning the right incentives and paying the right level of pay is very critical. So that's, those are the three things.
A lot of us are incubation managers here, so basically you've said go back and take a higher salary.
I mean, you guys need to be rewarded. It's not an easy job to be good at it.
Yeah. No, thank you.
Can I take a question to audience? Like,
you want to ask a question
to
audience?
Question.
Perfect,
yeah,
I like
yeah.
this.
How many of you in this room are running an incubator? Can you please? Okay, quite a few. How many of you run on Google Docs? Like try to collect data on Google Docs? Yeah, that's not the smartest way to do it, because every time you actually want to know more about your founders, you are asking them to fill the data again and again and again. That means you're not optimizing their time, right? They come back to our platform again and again because they actually apply to accelerators like these guys, and they give us a lot of data, which is important to you as well. And you're in turn, you're also saving their time, right? Yeah, thanks.
Super.
It's a best practice, that's why
I
wanted.
I agreed, and we would be showing a video of you guys in the end also. And next time I'll tell the organization to ensure you're there on sponsor logo.
We don't sponsor any event, actually.
Okay, people, questions, please keep them short and crisp, and do introduce yourself while doing that. I'll take a couple of mics around.
Hi, my name is Priyank. I'm from Ashoka University, like I introduced you before. My question is to Santosh and Prasanna. You guys both talked about data. How are you using the F6S data? Because you're collecting a lot of data. How are you using it? How can we as incubator managers benefit from that data? And Prasanna, you also collect a lot of data. So how does that data kind of feed back to the incubator manager?
Do you want to go first? Yeah. So as I said, right, in terms of founders keep coming back to F6S for multiple reasons. Unlike your applications, which probably run on your website or a Google Doc, in F6S, why do they come again and again and give us this important data? So one, they come to apply for all the accelerators in the world, like all of them run on F6S. They also come to actually claim a lot of credits. Like an incubator, you probably would want to make a lot of introductions, right? Like to a service provider, or to a product or a tool, and all of this. So F6S essentially delivers up to 483K worth of value for each user. And we also have a program called F6S Alpha, where we deliver up to $1 million worth of value.
How does it help the incubator manager?
Yeah, so when you use our dashboard, right? So
there are two parts to it. One, your application process is very important, application and evaluation. It runs on F6S. So you can add multiple evaluators. You can run multiple steps. Let's say you have four accelerators running under your incubator. You essentially want to get the data of all of these at one place, right? So that's one. And two, once you're associated with this startup, right, it might probably move out of your incubator. You might set a rule that probably 1 month is my graduation period, and 1 year is my graduation period, and after that, these startups go somewhere, and you don't have this data with you. Like, probably 5 years down the line, this startup may get exited, or probably move to another country where they might get exited, but you don't have absolutely any clue of all of this. And third, job creation, right? So job creation is one of the most important aspects which you can actually boast about as an incubator, that cumulatively all my startups have created this much of these many jobs. Today there is no metric for you to measure that as well. Probably you will measure it through the number of seats. Yeah.
Wait. So audience asks Chris questions, people give Chris answers, right?
Can you switch to the presentation, please? Next slide. Okay, so I'm just going to quickly show you some dashboards that we actually use in practice. So this, for example, is what the CEO or the incubation manager would see. For this is across product, marketing, hiring, fundraising, tech assistance, mentoring, GTM, fundraising, right? Across each of these, we look at a weekly basis how much progress we've made across our portfolio. Can you switch to the next slide? And then we're able to dig in to mentoring, for example, and see that half the startups are doing well on mentoring, half of them are doing average, and a couple of them haven't even started on getting their mentors in. Yeah, next slide. This is from the startups tasks across the last 4 months. This is real data, by the way, for the last cohort. Across the last 4 months, in the last batch, when did they get to each of their tasks? And very interesting thing that we found, we thought that when we tell them, hey, change the product in this way, they would do that first. But it turned out that the marketing and sales stuff that they do is what they do first. And then they figure out that, hey, from a tech perspective, it takes time to slot it into a roadmap and then do it. So all the tech changes that they said they would do, they ended up doing in the last 2 months. But the marketing and sales stuff, they were off the bat pretty much in the beginning. Slide. And the last one, this is just what we do as tasks and how we track them through the course of the program.
And in our case, there's no batch process, but still fundamentally things are similar, where one of the first thing we do is help them create a MIS and figure out the KPIs and just track that. So we've not made that awesome graphs, but as simple as that.
Hello, this is Ruchi Mehta, and I come from IIM Udaipur. So we are the ones who have recently been approved for an incubation center. So my problem is basically at a very initial stage when we are trying to build the team together. And for us, the mentoring support is going to be the backbone of our program. So what is it that we should look for while building our team together?
Awesome. I'll break that into two questions. One is your own team mentoring. And the second is the external mentors. Like, do you pay them equity? How does it work with them?
I'll just add on to my question. Having come from Udaipur, we won't be expecting too much of technology startups coming to our place. And right now, we are also not in a position to reject an idea. So I don't think we'll be in a position to actually categorize what sectors are we going to look at, because I think as time progresses, we'll understand what kind of sectors are we getting the interest from. So what should be the background of the mentors, what should be the capability of the team that we should look at? Yeah.
Okay. Any takers?
Yeah, so I think it is very interesting that you need to have, and you must have, a mentor in residence for sure. That somebody who is either a successful entrepreneur or who is a failed entrepreneur maybe, but wanting to contribute back to the startup ecosystem. And has been there, done that, and knows most important things about building a startup. So that is one very critical thing. You also need a technical support, very critical. Somebody who can understand multiple technology platforms and can mentor. So these two.
But as far as the external startups are concerned, I mean external mentors are concerned, I would suggest an industry participation is very important. So two things in your case, maybe alumni base, if you have a set of alumni whom you can tap into, they are the ones who will easily come to you without even demanding the airfare. Otherwise, if you are wanting somebody else to come and meet and spend a day or two, then you may have to provide those kind, but no equity, no funding is required, or no payment of fees and etc. Because that's not a great practice. Somebody who is keen to contribute back to startup ecosystem are the people who are going to make a difference. Thank
you. You know, just to as a framework, there are three C's. You know, it's competency, commitment, and clarity. So competency meaning, are they capable? Are they experts in their domain, right? Be it failed entrepreneur, successful entrepreneur, industrialist, whatever, right? Second is commitment. Are they willing to be there for the startup when the startup needs them? On a weekend or a Saturday morning, you know, so are they going to be there to take their call and provide them feedback? Third is clarity of purpose. You'll find a lot of people wanting to be mentors, but they are you know, people who are trying to be consultants. They're looking for a hook to get in. So those things are very critical. And second is, when you build your mentor network, you have to segment it in a matrix form. So by function and by industry. Function meaning finance, accounting, marketing, strategy, technology, and by industry. So, you know, somebody who is an IoT is not going to be great for agriculture or, you know, water. So you have to be very clear on that.
I'll just, one of the problems all fresh incubators face is you get these mentors who aren't good and you can't say no to them. One of the tricks we've used is, we tell the mentors in the beginning itself, we collect feedback on mentor hours and we share it with them. And then everyone understands, like if they get bad feedback, they themselves don't come. So it just works well. Roland can tell you more about, Roland, raise your hand. He can tell you more about it. Ting-ti-ting, this is ad break now. ISBA, those who aren't ISBA members, you should become ISBA members. A lot of what we talk is something I know, at least we end up discussing so much in various workshops and learning, cross-learning from various things ISBA does. So especially if you're a new incubator, you should genuinely think of becoming a ISBA member. Yeah, yeah. Ting-ti-ting. And by the way, I'm not like, yeah, I'm not getting paid for this. More questions? We'll go there. Take that mic. We'll come to you after this.
Hi, this is Hiranmay.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, from GTU Innovation Council. So I have a question. You know, in the incubation phase, I mean, though a couple of you are post-growth stage companies, if you look at the most of the incubators in India, they are academic, okay, supported by DST and all. So question to both sides of the guys who are running in private sector space and academic space. Which is the two thing in academic incubator you think are bottlenecks that you want to get eased off? And what, in the industrial sector, what are the two factors that you think are missing because you're not connected to an academic environment? So two things which you miss and two things which you miss.
And I count myself as academic one because I was co-heading IIM Ahmedabad's incubator before this. So we'll balance the scale here.
Or maybe you may want to take this one because I'm still at the academic incubator. So I don't want to say anything bad here.
Okay.
But there are two things, at least the way we look at it is, incubation process is a very much driven by the incubator manager and the team, right? So they have to be of high caliber. You cannot make it a part-time job or a job for some faculty who's got some extra time on their hand. This has to be professionals bought from the industry who understand it and are willing to do it and are compensated for it. So that's one challenge, right? Hiring the right people. And second is the speed of execution, because academic world moves at a very different pace compared to the industry, and innovation and startup is all about speed and scale. So we need to look at this whole thing and say, okay, how do we smooth out, take out the inefficiencies and make it faster?
So instead of repeating, I'll say two other challenges. One is, I think student entrepreneurs are tougher to work with, a lot tougher. And fundamentally, because all startups go through that tough phase, and if they're starting up in like second or third year, the tough phase, unfortunately, is when they're sitting for placements. And they'll just go for placements and you'll be like, I spent 2 years on this guy and now this is gone. So it is hard, it's a challenge. The second one is, the moment you're getting these external guys, right, and all the good incubators have worked that ways, you do run the risk of becoming a silo on the campus. And that element of how to ensure you keep engaging with the campus is something you have to very consciously think of and keep working on, because if you don't, it leads to issues with board, directors, prof start sort of thinking of you as a step baby or something. This is the corporate one.
Yeah, so as far as corporate one is concerned, I think the biggest issue could be a perception issue, that you have to deal with the perception as far as the startup ecosystem is concerned, because startup may always feel that if I get into a corporate, then there are possibilities that my idea can be stolen, my idea can be sucked into the organization, and I may not be able to run my startup. So these are the myths that you have to work with. You have to build credibility and trust. And unless you do that, it's not easy to attract the best of the startups to that ecosystem. And I think, I can't think of the second one.
Yeah. So, I think just to add one thing, right? The student startups that we see are not, in Santosh's words, battle tested. Right, they go after sometimes easy problems. They're not guided to go after real, crisply, well-defined problems. They go after something that's easy for them to reach, rather than go after something that's well-defined. And that's the challenge, that if you guys can help clarify the problem that somebody is solving, in 4 months, a student team can do wonders. Right? They can do a hell of a lot. And then they'll be much better prepared when they come to us.
So we do a question there, and then we'll come back.
Yeah, hi, I'm Karthik from iSquared, Incubating IoT Dreams. I have this question. We are a young incubator, just 4 months old, and we have two types of incubators. One, people who are seasoned entrepreneurs who kind of have some experience in the domain knowledge, and they have some ability to create some amazing products. And the second type of people is people who have some good ideas, and they are working on creating these new products. Now, what are the different stages these two types of incubators have to be taken out, taken through before they reach the accelerator stage?
This is a great question, right? So in the last batch, the average age of founders in our scalerator was 39, right? And what we are finding more and more is that as people with that serious domain expertise choose to become entrepreneurs, build teams around themselves, they are solving real deep problems that either people have or companies have, and so on and so forth. And they are able to do that much better, right? So what do they have? They already have industry connects. So that's the initial industry connects. They're not looking for you, from you, right? What don't they have? Many of them don't know what differentiates a startup from a corporate. So they may have worked in a Wipro or an Infosys or an IBM for 20 years, and they may still be in that model of building a business, and they will fail if they do that. So that difference, if you can get the mentors, subject matter experts who have been domain experts who became entrepreneurs, and connect them, that will serve them really, really well. Right? Because you don't need to teach them stuff. You just need to connect them to people who've done that. In the second category, which is people who are from industry, have some ideas, but not really as crisp, not maybe as much experience, and generalists, right? So they can do all kinds of things, but they don't know what they want to do. There, it's more like the student entrepreneurs again, but these guys have a little more capability. They have a little bit more range. So they're finding the right problem to solve. How can they find the right problem to solve within their capability and skill set becomes the what you can really help them with, right? And that can be done through a structured kind of a program.
So what will be the structure that you suggest?
I think we can take that offline, yeah. But our curriculum will help with that, with the first part, not so much the second part.
So if I were to still give a one-line answer, I'd say lean startup related structures work better with student and younger entrepreneurs, right? So you could, and there's enough knowledge available on it online too. Soma wanted to ask.
We'll come back.
So I have a completely different question since the session is related to practices. So I would like to talk about NDA, like non-disclosure agreement. You mentioned you have weekly review of their business plan. He mentioned that, you know, people come with the notion the idea can get copied or whatever. So do you sign NDA? Is it a good practice? Is it a bad practice? What is your thought on that?
Simple answer is we sign NDA with our cohort companies once they agree to join the cohort. We do not sign NDAs with any others, right? And for their fear of the company stealing the idea, let them try to come to the company and try to convince them that it's even a good idea in the first place. They're going to fail, right? Because everybody thinks my idea is strongest.
And
we do sign NDAs.
But post-incubation.
But once the incubation starts.
Once the incubation.
Not for people we are meeting.
So you think the incubator should not do that? Like when you are doing from zero to prototype stage?
You will. You will. You should.
Just, you sign NDAs, yes, no?
Just the same answer.
Same way.
Yep.
You don't care about it. You sign NDA, yes or no?
You know, NDA comes into play when there's more information to be shared, which might put, you know, company's well-being at risk, and that's when it's done. For a startup, when an idea is being created, there's no need for it. So once they get into the incubation program, that is when it becomes NDA based.
A related question you didn't ask is, if I have a startup already in a similar space and another one comes, what do we do? In our case, and I'm assuming that would be a similar answer for you guys, if it's different, let us know. What we do is, till we feel the first startup is working out and has got the best shot at it, we don't look at startups in similar space. But once we know this is not working out, we talk to the entrepreneur, we would select another one, and we would ensure both of them know that we are now selecting another startup too. Though that's not that often the case, so it's not that big a problem. You do it differently?
So within a batch, we don't take competing startups. Across batches, we talk to the whoever is already in our portfolio and just find out if there's any bad blood. Because if there's bad blood, then we would probably not take them. But otherwise, compete is okay.
So now, since we don't have that much time, what we'll do is we'll ask all of you to say the questions. We'll combine them together and try to answer them.
So maybe
there should be two mics in the audience.
Maybe we can record the question and then we can...
Yeah.
I have one question. With Rajiv ji, we have... I'm from NTSC Rajkot, NSIC Rajkot. We have set up incubation center 1 year back. My question is that do Reliance or any of their unit provide assistance, financial assistance in terms of loan to pass out trainees to have their own entity, their own venture? And second question is with the ISBA, that okay. Is that if we get, with the Gupta ji.
Sure, ask.
See, if we get associated, how to get associated, get registered with ISBA, and if we get registered, then what kind of the benefit we will get? As
sure.
An incubator's manager.
Sure. Other questions? So, while the mic reaches you, sir. Sir, aap, Sareen sir, why don't you ask a question?
Well, this is Sareen from Media. I have two things to ask, Pranay. One, so like now there are various models working. See, like some they charge rent for the facilities extended. Some they go for the equity participation. Some neither equity, neither rent. So now, how to decide that? You know, like how to go about it? That's one. Second, sustainability is very important. Now, How do we ensure that? Thank you.
Yes.
So you all do a lot of data analysis, right, for startup companies, and you all have a lot of models and graphs that you all were showing earlier. So question to you guys is, what should incubators look at in terms of while selecting their incubatees into their system to see as to that they'll be more successful? Any two points that you could suggest where companies have failed, depending on your data. And second question is, we have a lot of incubation centers who have their thrust areas defined, okay? So is there a system in place where all of these incubation centers join hands and pass on good incubatees to each other when they don't fall into their own domain? That way, we are kind of encouraging this whole system and this whole practice. So is there something in place? If not, can we put something in place? That's the other thing.
Sure. Hey, where's Casey vanished? can you ask Casey to come back? We'll ask him to answer the ISBA questions. Yeah. But, actually, ISBA questions are answered in the back of the schedule you have. And plus, I'll ask Casey to show his face. You can connect with him after this. And a lot of collaboration that you're talking of,
yeah.
ISBA is actually working on that.
Yes.
And I think a lot of it is also just this, right? We meeting regularly, talking, cocktails in the evening, all of this, right? It results in that. A better technology version of it, I don't think any of us have been using that yet. But by now, if you've been in incubation system for 2 years, you'll know everyone and you'll start collaborating. So
I was talking more of a process. Like.
Yeah, and we don't have that. You're right. We should have something.
I think we do have that process.
Dude, we've not used it, right? So you have that. We've not used it. We'll figure out how to do that. The Reliance specific question to you.
No. And then the answer is no.
You know, you raise a very critical point about financial sustainability, right? So in private sector, it's a very clear model, and it depends. They look at it as, you know, rent plus model. But especially when it comes from an academic institution, it becomes more challenging, right? As a nonprofit entity, we have to become self-sustainable. So the idea is, depending on the geography you're in, industry that you're focusing your incubator on, and the level of industry engagement you have to have 5-6 different revenue streams. One is from various programs. These will be industry-driven programs you're conducting, and you'll charge industry for it. Second is a base case rental you'll charge. Okay. Third is might take some equity. Fourth is corporate sponsorships. Fifth is CSR allocation where possible. And last is the government funding. Government funding shouldn't be the first one, it should be the last one to plug in the gap in the financial model. And the alumni is a critical factor. Thank you for bringing that up. Go out to the alumni, the industry, you know, the civic leaders. And once you have 5-6 revenue streams, you run your financial model, come up with probability, base case, bear case, bull case, see, you know, what sensitivities there are and fill in it. That's why you need professional people running it. Otherwise, it becomes really challenging to make it self-sustainable institute.
Though I think Sareen sir was just being polite when he asked this question because I know he conducts workshop exactly on this topic. So he runs EDI, which is Entrepreneurship Development Institute based out of Ahmedabad. So you could ask him these things too. I did catch hold of a couple of ISBA people and Casey, he's here. I call him the king of agri-incubation in India. He was running the incubator in Hyderabad and helped set up multiple agri incubators. He's now come full-time into ISBA, so he can talk to you more about that. After that, what we will do is, so Santosh, apart from all of what he said, he also is setting up a fund which will focus on investing in student startups. And there's a video we have about that after this. It's a 3-minute video, so we'll just play it after this.
Thank you, Pranay. I'm not a king. I'm just one of the person who was able to facilitate setting up of incubator and managing incubator. Now I'm with ISBA. Actually, this association, what it brings to you to the table, it's a collective voice of Indian startup ecosystem. It provides linkages and access to incubation community and resources. It has startup client access through market development activity. We are going to do a lot of initiatives to kickstart the demand for the startups. So this will be a part of thing. We do a lot of capacity building and training programs. Networking, this is the national conference like that. We do every year this national conference. We are planning events and managers conclave. Every year we do managers conclave. And incubator award is one thing which we are giving for the best incubator award of our community. So this today night evening, you will be seeing that ISBA awards. This is the 11th year we are doing this event. Of course, you'll get branding and recognition when you're a community members among this. And you'll know different of schemes and CSR initiative. And what we have been doing is we are closely working with different government agency for policy advocacy for both the startup ecosystem as well as innovation policy, both at central level and state level. So these are the things which you'll get benefited from ISBA. I also would like to mention that this financial year, we have planned 4 programs. So whosoever is interested, you can register for that. One is, of course, ISBA Certified Incubation Professional Program. So this will be a 5-day training program, which will be happening at Hyderabad on December 4th to December 8th. So this is one program. So you can register, and we have a registration desk in the front near the registration counter. Our staffs are there. You can register there. Second is ISBA CSR Incubator Partnership Workshop. So this is primarily to facilitate. There is an initiative that CSR corporates can fund the incubators. Neither the corporate know what it is, nor the incubators know how to access it. So we are trying to create an opportunity at Bombay. We'll be doing it at Sign IIT Bombay on November 16th to 17th. So that is the second initiative. The third one is Incubating Incubators Orientation Right Shop. See, lot of avenues have come for setting up incubators from different government channels. But people don't know how to write a proposal. So what we thought is, first we'll sensitize what is incubator and provide them an opportunity to interact with these different government departments about their schemes and criteria, and help you write a proposal in terms of what are the ingredients which are needed to write a proposal. This will be on January 31st to February 4th, and this will be at Delhi. The fourth one is, of course, international study tour for incubators and business managers. This we are doing in Seattle, USA, in continuation with INBA, World's Best Incubator Conference, which is happening in March 25th to April 2nd, 2016. So whosoever is interested, you can go and register at our registration desk. Thank you very much.
And in general, I'm a fanboy of ISBA because this is the first year ISBA has full-time functionaries, where KC and Raghu are working full-time on ISBA. And I think this is the first year where all of us are talking of startups and incubation with so much gusto. So I do think, forget what we've been doing. We should think of what ISBA will be doing. And when I say you should become members, you should think of, as a member, what should I be doing with ISBA, right? So that's the reason I am a fanboy, and I'm not getting paid for this.
Are you a member?
I'm a member, yes. I've been member as... I'm Ahmedabad's incubator also for a long time. And once we set up 91 Springboard, that's the first thing we did.
Thank you, Pranay. Really, actually, it is the commitment of... One of the things why we are able to conduct this conference is because of the members network. It is not what they gain out of it, but what they give out of for the system, for the co-development. Because this conference, we were to do it at Bombay in Trident. Everything was done, but some challenges we were not able to do it. But within around 3 weeks time frame, we were able to pull up this conference. This is basically because of support provided by team, like all the members, inclusive Pranay, Suresh is behind. A lot of people have supported this, especially in the member community, in many ways. Thank you.
So one, thanks a lot for being an amazing audience. I thank all my panelists for answering irritating questions that I was asking and the good questions audience was asking. We'll play the video that Santosh has put together for us. Thank you.
Water.
Global warming.
Rising energy prices.
Limited access to healthcare.
A crisis in education.
There's no question that we have a multitude of problems on this planet. I think we have the potential, not in centuries, but in the next two or three decades, the ability to really take on the world's big problems and solve them.
Now, some of the biggest and brightest innovations come from young people. Well, today we're going to introduce you to the Kairos Society. You're going to want to check this out because the people who are members of this are the CEOs of the future.
Student founded, actually, and the whole goal there is take on the big challenges in the world with entrepreneurs.
No place on earth where there's so much brilliant minds from around the world. Young people come together and they have so much of ideas.
The company was formed in Tel Aviv in Israel. We started in Portugal.
I'm at Stanford.
We're from Germany.
I'm from Shanghai, China.
There's never been a greater need or a better time to innovate. Innovation is the process by which we change the world. Innovation, to put it simply, is about making things better.
These students want to solve problems, and they're already solving problems in their own right. The question is, which problems will they solve, and what do you focus them on? How do you focus the next generation of entrepreneurs? That's what we do.
These are the guys who are going to find the next innovative solutions to some of these big problems, like clean tech, education, healthcare.
This is why some of the world's most influential leaders, individuals and corporations alike, are looking to Kairos fellows for a fresh perspective on how to tackle the next generation of global problems.
The tremendous advances in science and technology offer unprecedented opportunities to make a difference, especially through engagement with young entrepreneurs and innovators, such as those at the Kairos Society.
Just check out some of the mentors of this group: Bill Gates, Bill Clinton, Peter Diamandis of the XPRIZE Foundation, Duncan Niederauer. He's the CEO of the New York Stock Exchange.
Over the past 4 years, we've seen the growth of over 100 companies coming out of Kairos, taking on the big challenges like education, clean tech, healthcare, clean water.
Taking in $4.5 million in revenue in 30 days of being in production. Kairos really, over the years, has been the pivotal thing that's helped me get to this point.
Times, college entrepreneurship was confined to campus borders, and most entrepreneurs were confined to national borders. But Kairos transcends these boundaries, because in our interdependent world, there are no borders when it comes to the pressing issues we all face.
So they've set up a fund specifically to invest in student founders. So if you want to know more about it, you can catch him after the session. And with that, we wrap up the session. Thank you.